in my head, I always thought I was going to be a professional cricketer. And there's nothing else to life almost. You know, it's like, that was my role. I have to make it. It's like, I will make it. I used to actually live here. Guys came from there with all sorts of weapons. Actually, once I got hit by this guy here, I just can't believe it. I just can't believe I'm back here. I got suspended 3 times in my first 2 years. I was walking here once, and this guy ran me over here. To this day, I don't know why he ran me over. It's myself, my younger brother, Omar. When you come back to a place like this and you think this is where it all started, and it just feels like, it doesn't feel real, like, if that makes sense to you. Like, you're here one day and then, like, next minute you're playing in front of thousands of people at the Oval or Lords, and to play for England now regularly for the last 3-4 years, I feel so fortunate, and like, I just can't believe, I still can't believe I play for England regularly. It's weird, like, I feel very, very lucky. I like to know everybody that lives on that road. Still, the same, some of the same guys still live there. And people used to come from everywhere, literally down that road, that road, that road, that road. By the time you know it, you'd be playing against the road. So we used to play Stony Lane, which was my road, against Fulham Road. That was for us was a big game. As time went on, we used to play parks. There's a park further down called Borsley's Park. And they used to come over and play here, then we used to go over there and play there. Actually, when you think about it, it's quite crazy. It's amazing, but it's crazy. So this would be the stump. Obviously, here's the crease. But we play here. And this is like full of eggs. You know, in the shops there, this is where they put the eggs and stuff, like, and the bread and stuff. And we used to just pinch one. We'd put the stump here and make that would be the other line. And if you nicked it onto the wall, you were out. You'd have a square leg umpire sitting on the wall there, over there. And the umpire's here, one of the umpires here. And you'd probably have an umpire from the opposition, the team batting. So there was a bit of cheating sometimes. If I was there, I'd be looking to hit through that gap. I don't know if you can see through there. You'd just learn how to do it. Or you'd aim for that anyway. But you don't realize when you come in and play here a lot, or you go and play in your schools and stuff, you're actually hitting so many balls that you are becoming better without even realizing, I guess. And obviously straight was a big hit at the time for me. But a spinner, again, like, if a spinner was on, I'd try and belt him straight as I could. I learned so much in this park. I remember there was a time I couldn't play as a young kid. I must have been 12, 13, off my hip. And I ended up practicing with my brothers here, just trying to, and then I remember playing a test match here, and I just kept hitting the guy onto the road. And because I was playing county cricket as well at the time, age groups, I took it into there, and I remember thinking how much it worked, just even just practicing off my hip and stuff. But I had that sort of street sort of wires about me where I just wanted to prove that I was the best one here and stuff. So I always had that competitive edge as well, you know. People probably see me as sort of laid back. I have my own way of being competitive, I think, and I think that helps me a lot. I was definitely one of the better players there. How you doing? That guy there, Michael, he was a good friend of mine, actually. His grandparents live over there, and he's actually quite a good footballer and stuff. You see, like, regularly when I'm around here, everyone, the park is still here. They're still around, they just, no one comes anymore. I remember there's a group of older guys playing, and we were playing on the bank, we were playing football. The guys came from there with all sorts of weapons, and I remember they just charged this group of guys playing here, and me and my brothers just ran because it was so scary, you know. Like, the guys were like big, I don't know, you know, those things that they spin around, it's like metal bars and stuff. And I was, you know, there was times like that as well, but again, you learn to run sometimes when you need to. For us, this was a safe place to be, even though it was a rough place. It doesn't really make that much sense to someone, but this was our go-to place. Like, if ever there was problems, you know, away from in school, whatever, you come here and you sort of take your mind off things and come and play your football, cricket, spend all your day here, literally until the sunset, and then go home. Even though it was rough at the time, it felt safe because there wasn't the knives and the guns as it is probably now. It wasn't as ruthless, I don't think, even though it was pretty rough at the time still. Actually, once I got hit by this guy here, and I saw one of the senior guys, and he went and sorted it. I never did anything, but he warned the guy, and never again. Like, you know, it was that sort of upbringing. Great memories. Even when I drive past, I always feel like I wish, if there was any time in my life, I know it never happened. I'd love to come back to those days that I used to come here all the time. No worries about nothing. You just play cricket, you play football, go home, look forward to the next day because you're gonna do exactly the same thing. Little things that give you that warm feeling inside that you feel, makes you feel like almost like a human being sometimes. Sometimes you get caught up in everything else that you forget your roots, or you forget where you're from, you forget your friends. And I try never to do that. I try and always know that I'm from here and this will always be. I'd always say I'm from Spark Hill. Yeah, it's my area here. Love it. You work so hard as a youngster to become whatever you want to become, and then the time comes and you probably give up. And I think that was another thing. My dad never ever gave up. I think he saw from an early age that we were quite talented and stuff, and he was like, no, he was adamant that we had to make it. And even though he had some pressure from family about, you know, why are they playing cricket, they're wasting their time, there's no career in it, and it's hard because of where we're from and our backgrounds and stuff. But my dad was like, no, they're gonna do something. Because my dad knew what was going on in terms of cricket. And he's like, no, they're gonna do something and things like that. Whenever I think about this school, it just brings great feelings and memories and things like that. Just can't believe it. I just can't believe I'm back here after so long. I'd finish here and then straight to the park. And sometimes my mum would take us to the mosque, or think that we're going to the mosque, but we'd go straight to the park. So we used to make our way, we used to walk up to the road of the mosque and then do a U-turn from the other side and straight into the park. I've not been back probably since I left, actually. I remember coming back once, and since then I've not come back. I don't think I was ever naughty or anything like that. Not in primary school anyway. I still love it. I absolutely love it. My first day here, my older brother, he said he's gonna, because obviously we're in nursery. I remember he came to this gate. This gate was a lot longer, I think, at the time. And we used to be on this climbing frame here. And he came and said hello to me. And that's the first memory I have of this school, when he said hello. And I just knew that because he was my older, because obviously you're a little bit scared, and I felt real safe because he was here and stuff like that. And I remember after that day, I was fine. I think my favorite time was when my sister, my brother, my younger brother, we were all in here at the same time. It just brings back those memories when you were young and innocent. I remember these, I don't know what year was that? 1995. We were doing Theseus and the Minotaur. Minotaur, what is it called? I can't remember what it was. And I was one of them, and I was so shy, and I didn't want to do it. The teacher forced me, and then I said to the teacher, I can't do it. I've never been the brightest or anything like that, but I knew what was going on. Sometimes I was so into sport though. I used to love just going outside. I can't wait to leave to get outside to play. Play time, dinner time, whatever it was. I think everybody knew that we were so interested in cricket that we were, I think even the teachers and other teachers knew that we were gonna try and get somewhere as cricketers. And When I went to South Africa, and I was always proud to tell people that I was from Nelson Mandela School, and everyone's like, oh, wow, you know, Nelson, because he's so big over there, obviously. And I remember when I used to tell people that I really feel proud of it, and when I told people that he came to our school, and because people over there would have loved to have met him, and so yeah, I used to rub it in a little bit. You know what I remember about here? That spelling, so you see, like, flip this long spelling books here, and you'd have to, like, memorize and learn the spelling of all these words and stuff. Probably still don't know them. Look how small these chairs are. Yeah, the ones. I think sometimes you forget how lucky you are that you brought up in this way, and there's children out there who don't have anything. And as you get older, you realize how fortunate you are with what you had as a kid, and they all make a big difference into whatever you want to try and become. So for me, this was the best primary school you could ever come to. And sometimes when I had training and stuff like that, and the school would allow me to, they would understand, and I think that made a massive difference into me developing as a cricketer. But you have such a mixture here in terms of, you just have a bit of everything.
Yeah.
All different types of religions to colour, like in terms of, you have a lot of Arabs, Pakistani backgrounds, Bangladeshi, like they're all different. Like, it's great because you sort of just learn to get on with everyone. And when you're a child, you don't really care. And to be honest with you, nobody should ever care what colour somebody is or what religion someone is. It's end of the day, we're all human beings and things like that, and that's what you learn straight away. You don't learn none of the stuff. And I used to actually live here. This is 197. That used to be my house. So as you can see, it's quite a busy road. I used to see there was a bus that I could take to here and then get to the school. But because my friends used to take the other bus, I used to always jump in with them. So I used to walk a little bit and then bus it. And I'll show you this one place. We used to call it the churchyard. And this is where I remember there was fights almost every single day. I was very fortunate because my friends, as soon as they got in trouble, they always used to say, look, you play cricket, we don't want you to join in. We don't want you to take part in it. And even though I knew that was best, I also felt, because they were my friends and my best friends, that I needed to do something or help them. But initially, I always used to try and avoid or try and stop it. I think with me, because I had a sort of vision or something that I was able to see a future in, I sort of, that kept me going and grounded, and you sort of know what's best for it and what's not. Some of my mates, they probably didn't have that, sort of not sure what they wanted to be or what. And as soon as you get caught up in it, it's very difficult to come out of it. So that guy coaching there now, he was in my year and he was in my school team. Yeah, I always felt if I ever play for England or a county player or become like a well-known guy, I always thought, you know, I'm never gonna change or feel like I'm bigger than everybody else or higher than anybody else in any sort of way. I'll come here end of every year, every season, we have a 10-over competition here. People from all over the country come on this particular ground. 10 overs a team, and I still play in that. A couple of thousand people here, even though it's not as much as what obviously we play at Lords and stuff, but the pressure of people wanting to get you out because you're an England player, that pressure is big. And I feel that pressure more than probably when I'm sometimes playing for England. I think I do it because it makes me feel part of the community and makes them feel like I'm still part of it as well. Because it's something I would have done before. So because I would have done it then, I don't see why I should stop now. I want to be able to look back and think, you know what, I played at the best grounds in the world as well as still at the same time I was playing at my local club grounds or my school ground, or I still look back and think, you know what, I never ever thought I was too big to play for anybody else or not play for people or stuff like that. You know, part of my role as a cricketer is to inspire or make people feel part of who I am. And so when they watch me on TV, they feel very happy and proud that they know me, or, you know, I've shook their hand or whatever it is, you know. And they do come up to me and hopefully inspire the generations to come to play cricket as well, and to try and play for England and things like that. Give them some sort of, you know, we talked about the vision earlier, it's give them some sort of vision, and hopefully their parents to push them as well. Secondary school, I became a bit more of a, not a rebel. Rebel's a harsh word. I'd say I was a bit more, I had the guts to do a few more things. Things that you look back and think, well, why? Why did I do that or stuff? But at the time, you know, you have a laugh with your friends, and you're probably going through that age, that stage where your personality is changing and things like that. I got suspended 3 times in my first 2 years for a week. I was on report for a couple of years. One was for bad language. One was for, we took stopwatches and just threw them in the science lab. You know, it's just like messing around. But, you know, detention, I couldn't afford to get detention because my dad, because I was training from 13 to 15, my dad said to me, every day you're going to train. Just give me 2 years of your life and then you can do what you want after that. So for them 2 years, there was no detention. I couldn't afford detention or couldn't afford to get kept behind and stuff, so I had to behave myself. At the time when you're struggling financially and stuff, my dad used to somehow get a booking or take his time out and stuff, so, you know, I had to make sure I fulfilled those 2 years. That was the best thing I think my dad ever did for us. And I'm forever grateful for that, because I know it could have turned out a lot worse. Cricket was massive here. We were always known for being a strong side. We got into nationals, we went to London and we played against like Bedford School and all these like King Edwards and stuff, and we used to smash them and come back. But we used to love it because, like I said, we always liked the underdogs, and we didn't have much between us and stuff, but we used to love them, just smash the teams and then come back. Just enjoy it. I think throughout my school years, we probably lost 2 or 3 games max. And I remember we played against Solihull Hull School. They had like a couple of county players at the time. And we went there, we were chasing 130, and we won in 8 overs, me and this guy. It was to us, because we were so used to playing on a wicket like this, which is not that easy, but that was a good pitch, and we just absolutely smashed. But we used to love, that is the kind of stuff that we used to thrive on. Go out there and just smash other teams. A lot of the guys who I played with, they couldn't afford bats, pads and stuff, so we always used to just share. As a county player, I had all the equipment, and I used to share all my stuff, and when I got out, I'd give my pads to the next guy going in and stuff. And those are the kind of memories that you kind of cherish forever and sort of look back and think how good they were and stuff like that. So we always felt like, no, we've got to prove to these out that we're better than them at cricket. That's the most important thing. If they want to play us at cricket, then we're going to beat them. I think I always have had that mentality, even when we're playing against Australia or whoever and they think they are like bigger, better, I always, that, you know, drives you and you want to show them that at cricket we're going to be better than you today and stuff like that. So, yeah.
Was this your old school as well?
Yeah.
We came here.
Yeah, I know him. We went to France together, didn't
we? We went to the skiing trip together, Moeen, you remember?
Yeah.
MashaAllah, how are you?
Can I take a picture with you in the background?
Yeah, no worries.
Thanks, man.
Come on down, Aja.
Perfect. Nice. Thanks a lot, Maris.
Moeen, it's really nice to see you. JazakAllah. We're always following you. We've always got you in our duas and everything.
Thanks, bro. JazakAllah. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you.
So on this road, right, I was walking here once. I used to meet my father at the bottom of the road. And this guy ran me over here on purpose. Out of nowhere. I'll tell you exactly where. To this day, I don't know why he ran me over. Right here. Right opposite those houses. So here, he came so fast down this way. I stood against this bush here and he came back, and there's no cars on this side. So I thought there was two girls in front of me from the sixth form. I thought he was going to go and speak to them. And all of a sudden, like, he reversed it and he fast just went bang straight into me and I fell back into the bush. And his car tilted on its head. So I ran down the bottom of this road, like in shock, and my leg was pouring with blood. And so I ran all the way down, phoned my dad. I didn't tell him on the phone, I was in shock. And he came, picked me up, and he goes, he saw me limping, so what happened? So I got in the car, said, this guy ran me over, so he went. And the guy goes to my dad. The first thing he said to my dad is, you're lucky he's still alive. And my dad just went mad. But by the time, because the car was tilted, the fire brigade had come and there was a lot of, obviously, panic and stuff. And I couldn't, to this day, I don't know why he ran me over. So the police took statements off me and I was really scared. I didn't even come out of my house for, well, as in, apart from going to school for a while. Thankfully, there was a bush under the side and I fell back into the bush and it was a bit uphill and sort of got away with it. If it was a wall, it was done. It's crazy. I think it was 9 or 10 I came here. I reckon I came here at the best time. There's a lot of youth cricket going on. And the guy, Trevor, who we're going to meet now, he really took me under his wing. I think he was in charge of the youth and he used to live just over here. And he used to pick us up. Like, my dad used to struggle sometimes to drop us off or to bring us, like, we didn't have a car or whatever. And he'd pick us up and then bring us here. But he was a lovely guy. He always looked after me and my brothers and my father. Trev, how are you? It's been a very long time. You well?
Good to see you. Great. I'm good. Good to see you.
You well?
Good. Yeah, I haven't seen him since he was 15, 16, since he went on from here. So it is lovely to see him back, yeah. He wanted to be a professional cricketer from that age, 11, 12, 13. When he went out to bat, he went to make big runs and make them quickly. He wanted the ball out of the ground and very often it happened. If the first ball was a bad ball, it would go for six. There was no playing in. He wasn't very big, there was not much of him. But because he was so effortless and his timing was so good, he could have batted all afternoon. So, you know, physically to hit that, you know, some games, 8 sixes, 10 sixes in that 195, you know, there were 21 fours and 15 sixes. Physically, for a lad of that age, in 20 overs, it's a lot of work, that is. You could just tell that he was very special.
A lot of the people here thought I was going to become an international player. And obviously, as a player, you don't really see that too much. You just carry on and try and be the best you can. Playing here was great because when I was training at Warwickshire at the time in the academy, it was about tightening my technique up and leaving balls and, you know, sorting my defence out, which was a problem at the time. Whereas when I was here, I just play my shots and almost go the other way. So it was a great balance of having both of them. It was great, obviously, and to get 195, but it was a game where my dad's friend's son was playing, and he was 15, and he got out somebody the year before, and so he came to my house, and they were talking about how they're going to get me out, and almost for the first time playing mind games with me, and I was 14, I didn't really know, and I was very determined to put him in his place. Myself, my younger brother, Omar, this guy, Valid, he's one of my best mates still. A lot of us played county cricket, so there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. About 6, 7 of us played county cricket. That's Trevor's two sons, who are good friends of mine. This guy I bumped into not long ago, actually, James Foraker. So, and he was playing Warwickshire at the time as a left-arm seaman. That's obviously Trevor. But that picture is sort of typical of myself, where I'm pretty quiet, like, never said a lot as a kid, but when I went out and played, I would try and express all my feelings when I was playing. I was very shy. I would be very afraid to speak in front of people, or even doing something like this, I'd be very afraid of it. Talking to the teammates, making a speech, whatever it was, cricket has helped me so much, and I think it's something from an Asian sort of background, we were very shy of this kind of thing, and It's something over time I've got better, I've got used to doing, and I'm not afraid anymore. And cricket has changed my life so much in terms of that. For me to have played for England is an incredible achievement for myself and for my family, and from the hard work that we've put in and the sacrifice as a family that we've put in and a community that people have helped me with as well. Along the way, I feel like I'm, even though I won't be able to repay that, I feel like I'm showing that it wasn't a waste of time or it wasn't wasted. And I love it when my parents come to watch me play, and my friends come and watch who helped me along the way, and they had to go through a lot more than what I go through. So I feel like I'm repaying them in terms of them being proud of me, and where my dad can be happy, like, you know, keep his head up high and say, look, my son plays for England. And that to me means everything.
To the air, and six. Tremendous ovation for Moeen Ali. What a shot that is. Goes again, this side, leg side. Made that three sixes in the over. That pretty much sums up the innings and sums up Moeen Ali.
Ali.
It's three red and drill.
What a way to end a test match. Moeen Ali with the first hat trick for an England spinner since 1938-39.
It's been a fantastic day. I mean, going down memory lane, you sort of bring back all those feelings and the memories, obviously. And it's just a great place to be, I think. And also, it makes you humble that you realise where you're actually from. Sometimes you can forget that. To play from a ground like this, or my school ground, or my park, it's almost like it recharges your batteries. Days like today, and sort of you go back to the reason why you played cricket, you remind yourself the reason why you played, and your sort of humble beginnings and stuff like that. And it's been a fantastic day, and I've loved every minute of it.
Super catch.
There were times when you would doubt yourself and people would doubt you, and it was a lot harder for the Asian community to break through into the system. But growing up, and you had to be, you know, a lot better than the rest. It wasn't just a thing of having fun, it was a thing of actually developing and knowing that if I come here and put the hard work in, things will definitely get a lot better.
Back, grew up here with my brothers and dad as well. Used to play a cricket ball in these nets. Years ago, I used to, you know, run around the park. Dad made us run around the park as well.
You know, you'd be there pushing us initially to start with, making sure, you know, you get your runs in, you get your fitness in. You have to, it's compulsory. You need to. You know, it's all you know, good playing, you know, batting and bowling. But if you're not really, you know, fit enough to play cricket in that sense, then you know you need to work hard.
Me and my two brothers and my dad, we all used to play one team together back, I don't know how many years ago that must have been, when I was probably 8, 9, 10. And then my dad just threw me the ball and got me into leg spin. So it was my dad, you know, who first started off, you know, for me playing cricket, leg spin and batting as well.
He always probably had a dream of me, you know, playing for England, playing, you know, probably, you know, representing Yorkshire first, and obviously England came along. So for him, it was, you know, he sacrificed probably all his, you know, all his life or whatever to get me where I am today. So, you know, a lot of, you know, big thanks goes to him for, you know, for everything that he's, you know, given me. So, you know, whatever my dad passed on to me, I'll do the same thing, you know, hopefully with my little ones, you know, as they grow up, giving them the opportunity as well that, you know, my father gave me.
Yeah!
Ball in! Oh, what a wicket! That attempt at a long serious innings is over, courtesy of Adil Rashid.
Well, this is exactly why Rashid is so important to this one-day team, because he can do this. He can get the best players in the world out.
You know, there were times growing up and you would doubt yourself and people would doubt you, knowing that, you know, you're not going to make it. It's hard to get through the Yorkshire system, especially, you know, knowing their history or whatever it is. A lot of people said it's tough work, it's hard work. So growing up, personally, me, I knew I had to be a lot better than the rest. So my father knew that as well, so he would push me in that sense, making sure, you know what, if you've got to train, you've got to train harder than everybody, you've got to make sure you're better than everybody, because of the system and how things worked back then, it was harder for the Asian community to break through into that system. But, you know, thankfully, thank God, and, you know, my father, whatever, they really give me that support, really push me towards, you know, making sure that I am, you know, fully ready. So as a result, when I played for under 11s, 13s and 15s, I did fairly well, and it pushed through towards the professional level.
Well, Adil Rashid is a very good young, talented leg spinner. A young lad, plenty of promise. Now, Adil Rashid. Oh dear, that's a wide, has to be. Big hit from Ponting, has he got all of it? Yes, he has. There he goes again, and is that even better? It's majestic.
Rashid bowled brilliantly at the Oval, then they left him out for two matches, his confidence is gone.
There was a period probably between 2010 and 12 where I was struggling in cricket. Right, I was struggling in cricket, I wasn't doing well or whatever, and in life in general I was a bit wayward or whatever it was, and you know, I really sat down and thought to myself, I really need to, sort my cricket out as well. So I made a bit of a U-turn towards, like I said, I need to go back towards, you know, to my religion. That's right, I need to start praying. I need to start, you know, doing the things that, as what Muslims do, be, you know, give charity and do this and be a good person and, you know, change the whole way of my life. And that's what I did. And just by chance, everything else, my life started turning around. Like you say, you got married, you get kids, and cricket starts going on an incline, and everything else started falling into place, you see. Ultimately, religion really gets me on a different level spiritually and as a person.
He's in the side, he's been picked. Adil Rashid is going to bowl. Can he perform here for England? That's the question.
Right, that was good. That's in the air. That might be caught. Oh, it is caught too. Adil Rashid has a wicket. Out.
Well, that might be close. Yes, four now for Adil Rashid.
And that is 50 for Adil Rashid. It means so, so much to him. Lovely innings. The story really is Adil Rashid.
As a British Muslim, you know, representing England, you know, it means a lot to me, especially from where I grew up and to where I'm now. You know, all the hurdles that I had to overcome. You know, personally for myself, cricketing point of view, and also, you know, as a Muslim I am. You know, the hurdles I had to come across there. As time's gone on, I feel as though I have become more of a role model, especially representing England, and a lot of now kids coming through playing cricket as well. You know, they look up to the likes of myself and. And Moeen Ali, who are representing England. You know, it's a happy moment for us, knowing that there are kids out there looking up to us, knowing that there is hope for them as well to, you know, play international cricket or play cricket for, you know, their counties, wherever it is. So hopefully, like I say, me and Mo can still be like inspiration for a long time coming. Let's see wrong then. What are you gonna make him do? Game driving? Perfect. Oh, good effort. Good effort. Have you got a wrong end? You have got a wrong end. Let's get him through the gate. Go through the gate, yeah. It's nice, that. Yeah, you keep working. Oh, well balled. Nice, lads. How are we getting him out? Look to it. Okay, I'll tell you. Try getting balled. Both of you try getting balled. He looks like a good player. So you've got to get him bowled. How are we going to get him bowled? Have the mindset when you're bowling. If you're going to pitch your leg, imagine that.
hitting off. So imagine that and then try to do it. That was hitting middle and off. Keep repeating that, repeat, repeat, repeat. Keep having that same mindset. Well, ball. And if you ball it short, it doesn't matter. You ball it short, don't, you know? And if you ball it full, it doesn't matter. It's practice, nobody's perfect. We're all gonna ball bad balls, good balls. But you've got to enjoy what you're doing. If you don't enjoy it, it's gonna be tough work. So you've got to enjoy it. And if you ball a bad ball, it doesn't matter.
If you look, looking back at it, probably 10, 15 years ago, I wouldn't have imagined I would have been where I'm in this position today. Something like you don't really think that could happen, you know, playing for England, especially, you know, at the highest level. It happens, everything happens for a reason, and good journey so far. You know, hopefully it'll continue for a lot longer.
Get, yeah.
Oh yes, what brilliant cricket.
Yeah.
That's out. Oh, he's done it with the catch now, Adil Rashid.
Yeah.
Hey, up.
Katherine,
you're right, Tony.
Are
we going for a handshake?
I know. And you're tall. You're as tall as me now.
I'm definitely taller than Shoza.
Oh, hey, mate.
Hey, you're right.
Yeah,
been a while,
well.
Hasn't it?
It has, yeah.
Yeah, lovely. Yeah. Proper bowling.
Hit your lens straight away and then built pressure.
I really listened to Tony that day. Line and length.
Line and length, Katherine. Line and length.
Yeah.
Not out again.
You'd think they'd start to learn to get me up order. 4 for 7. You look, yeah, absolutely destroyed that top order.
Boys being bowled out by a girl.
Yeah.
It was like
tragic. And the
I'm
rest.
Never gonna play. I've been bowled. How could I tell my dad? I've been bowled out by a girl.
No less.
Those were the days. Let me find the page that it's on.
Could quite easily have been anything growing up. I was I wasn't great at school. I was much more like sporty and loved like playing sports and being involved actively, like classroom stuff just was terrible. I tried my best, but I guess when I went down in sets, things got harder, like kids didn't listen, the teachers refused to teach. There was so many people that got expelled because of drugs and just like going out and drinking at like 13, 14. But kids can just be, they can just be horrible sometimes. And you know, I was pretty overweight at school. Didn't have good fashion sense, I guess. My parents are pretty old school and I had my brother's hand-me-downs, which is really embarrassing. But you know, that's just how it was. I'm the youngest of six. My parents weren't gonna buy new clothes for all six of us, were they? So. I got teased for that. I got teased for being fat. Teased for being a loner, I guess. And yeah, it's just really horrible time. I guess I'm lucky to have a good family and to grow up in a sporting environment. So I guess I have my parents to thank for pushing me as much as they did. This is my my home, the Hawthorns. It's changed a bit throughout the years. So I used to come out here, and there's a brick up there, which is quite clearly like an odd brick on its own. And I'd stay out here, and I wouldn't let myself go back in the house until I'd hit the brick. They'd be like, "You coming in for your dinner?" I'm like, "No, 5 more minutes." Oh yes, first time. I'm only doing it one now. That's it. Go on, drop the mic. Should we go straight in there? Sit, sit, paw. Other paw?
Yes.
Oh boy. Oh yes. He was on -9 when I was. Oh. My two nieces, They're both 2 years old now, but they play with my old toys. Like I said, we're a pretty frugal family. Everything's passed down, hence the teddy bear. We had a best friend from junior school going to senior school. And, like kids do, they don't really know about emotions and how they hurt people. And she just stopped being my best friend one day. And then I was like, crikey, who do I have around me? I didn't have anyone. It just turned me into a massive introvert and a bit of an oddball. And just went into a bad path. I was, you know, I would drink and they wouldn't know I would drink. I was going down a pretty bad path, to be honest, and I put on a lot of weight. Between the ages of 11 and 15, I was pretty big. I was about 14 and a half stone. But it certainly had an impact on my career, my future. Luckily, not for the worse, but certainly for that period of time, I just quit. I didn't want to be around other people, certainly people who looked a lot different to me physically. It was embarrassing, I was ashamed of myself, and I didn't want to be in that environment, and especially at the time, the coaching staff and people around, not Paul and Tony, but within the England women's setup, were not very nice people. I came across a couple of coaches that just were really hard-nosed and old-school, and they'd be effing and blinding, and I was 14-year-old girl, and that terrified me, and I begged my dad and my mom not to bring me back to a trial, an England trial like that again. So I definitely gave up because of my image. I had the lowest self-esteem ever. I still struggle with it now, and people will relate to that. I kept playing my club stuff. I didn't stop playing for Barnsley. I just always felt quite at home there, quite comfortable, and always had my dad there to hold my hand if I needed. You just got to remember you're not actually on your own, and it does end, and it makes you become a better person. The day that I got willpower, when willpower came into my life, I was just basically upstairs and looked in the mirror one day and I was just like, I don't want to be that anymore. Started doing the jogging with my dad. So he's a runner. What do? I'll go running with my dad to get fit. So he would take me on runs and I'd make little checkpoints and go as far as I possibly could each time. And yeah, it went on for 3 months and there I was, 2 stone lighter and feeling way better about myself. Like I belonged again within society. We'd set off down here. And he wouldn't tell me how far we were going because obviously he didn't want to defeat me mentally before I've even started. But he said, we'll run to the Ducks and back as a starter. But I didn't know where the Ducks were, but we'd head up this hill and I'd get to like this lamppost here, 100 yards away, and I'd be absolutely blowing. And now, thinking of that, that's shocking, that's so unfit, but it's all I could manage at the time and had to run back from that lamppost. And then the next time I'd run to this house on the left, I'd run to that house and back. And then the next time, the next week, I'd run to this little farm on the left and back until eventually, you know, I did make it to the Ducks and I was well chuffed with myself that I made it to the Ducks and back with my dad, because obviously me knowing how fit he is, I thought that this was a really long way and I was really chuffed with myself, this little pond with the little ducks in on the right, just there and back, and as you can see, we've gone about 100 metres. I came across Paul Shaw between 16 and 18 and I'd literally just come near the end of my journey of losing the weight and my focus wasn't centred around that anymore. It was just about going out then and figuring things out, like being an older teen, the stuff you go through at that age, and being at college and then what do I want to do with my life? And here comes Paul Shaw, the philosopher. He literally is, he's all about, you know, the mental side of it and who you are as a person and shaping the better you.
Oh yeah, 2010. Mm. That was 8 years ago.
Yeah, I know.
Time flying, yeah, having fun.
Good old days. One of my first test shirts.
Is that one of your shirts?
Proper old school. That's the I think that's the first shirt I ever got, an Admiral one. And my signature's all faded. 2004, look. It was my first ever game. Test match, my debut against New Zealand at Scarborough.
Yeah, I came across Katherine first at 15, 16, but she was a little bit older, started working with her, probably 18, really seriously, wasn't it?
Mm.
And I knew within a couple of sessions that, one, she had so much potential, but more important than that, she got an incredible desire to be the best that she could be and wanted to enjoy the game again. So we worked together and worked with that raw ability, and then I mean, there's a fairly famous story that we'd been working together a while, and Katherine said, "Do you think I could play for England?" And I said, "If you do this, you do this, we work together in this way, then I reckon probably a couple of years or so." She proved me wrong. She did it in 6 months.
Yeah. Paul was more of a person that made me understand like the potential I had. For me, like, I've been a cricketer, it's not been about all the skills and technically how good you are, it's having a proper relationship, just getting to know myself as a person, being more confident, really honing in on the simple things, and giving me loads of confidence and self-belief in myself enough to be able to put myself out there, because I certainly never wanted to do that. The thought of putting myself out was terrifying. So playing for England wasn't an option for me, really. It was more just being the best I could be.
Seeing it perform, being the world's leading cricketer and spearheading England's attack, absolutely fantastic. But more importantly than that, winning World Cups and performing like she has and won back-to-back Ashes, it's inspired thousands upon thousands of young girls to play this game. And I think that's the greatest thing, probably the greatest thing that you have achieved, in my opinion, because knowing that to those young girls there's now a pathway as a career, and they can follow Katherine, but they can be the next Katherine.
Yeah.
Pretty inspirational.
I'm so exhausted. We were all in the middle of the pitch and everybody was piling on Anya, and I was on my way to her like going crazy, and then just before I got there to do the pylon I just stopped. And I just dropped to the floor, and like it was just all these emotions just hit me at once, and I just couldn't move. PCB had sorted out some boxes for our families around the middle, so we had that visual point, whereas normally you don't know where the hell they are. And I'm like, before a game, I'm always searching around, where are they? Because I hate playing, I hate starting a game without knowing where they are. And they were there the whole time, so I knew exactly where they were, and just could turn to them after and just see them all stood up and really going for it was great, and my two new nieces were there as well to see that point, which, you know, there's actually a picture of me and my dad and me and my brother. So like I said, my dad pushed me to be probably playing for England. My brother taught me everything I knew. There's a picture of me with each of them and just outside the long room cuddling when they finally came down, and they're really, really emotional pictures actually. You do get to see just how proud at times you make your family when they're there and they're sharing those moments with you. And you can't replace those moments. And I don't think they understand either how much that means to you, just them being there, regardless of them actually telling you that they're proud of you. So, yeah, if it weren't for my family, I wouldn't be where I am today. And without their support, through the years, I wouldn't have done it either, so it means the world. This is not okay. Can we stop talking now?
My grandma used to say, like, if he could see, it'd be dangerous. And I think I think it might well have been.
Good
when I was born, there was all sorts of complications and the heart condition, and they said we're not sure he can hear or whether he's like can speak or anything like that. So they said I wasn't gonna ride a bike, I wasn't gonna do this, that, and the other, and it just forced like my mum and dad just said, I'm not having any of that. You know, wherever we went to, you know, it's just like Sai's gonna be able to do that. You know, just because other kids are doing it, like he's definitely gonna be able to do it as well, and it all stemmed from them. Pushing me and making me believe actually you can go and do it, because it'd be very easy to just say, oh well, you know, I can't see very well so I can't do that, but that was never ever an option, you know. But at school it was tough. She used to get beaten up and things like that, and my shoulder broken once, and I was determined to not stay off school. I'm sure those years set me in good stead to be strong, because you had to be. You just had to pick yourself up and get on with it, and you know, overcome your demons and go places you didn't want to go. Go back to school every day, go out, you know, make sure that you didn't just stay at home. And so, you know, all of that was going on, and my parents had to make a pretty tough decision, you know, whether to send me away to boarding school. And that was probably the hardest decision they ever had to make, but they sent me. And it's the best thing they could have done for me. It sent me to a place where, you know, other people had a visual impairment and stuff like that, but cricket was really popular at that school, and the school had a reputation for it. And yeah, like, just got into it straight away, really. I enjoyed the fact that there was a lot of different pressures. I enjoyed the fact that there were so many different roles in the game. It wasn't just like football. You know, I really felt like you won as a team, you lost as a team. But yeah, I got noticed, I got invited to an England trial when I was 14, and got lucky, I think. And then I went to a World Cup when I was 16. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, I never ever wanted to go to uni. I never wanted to go. I guess, you know, my family wanted me to go. My mum put a lot of pressure on me to go to uni, which, you know, is probably fair enough, like, you know, especially you got a visual impairment, like you need a degree, you need a qualification, and that's all fair enough, isn't it? But I mean, it was a daunting thing as well, because you were going back into that mainstream setting. Not that I didn't have friends that were mainstream, but you go back into that mainstream setting where, again, you're the different one. Like, and so that was daunting for me. I ended up down in Brighton. There's like seven bedrooms, and this is my gaff. This is my one here. So I had the lower floor room, and you've got the flat roof, and out the back, you just go up into the flat roof. You know, that party's up there. Yeah. Neighbours hated us. I was big into my fitness and stuff, like when I first went to uni, and I tried to carry that on. And but then, you know, everyone was in the drug game around here. A lot of pressure to be in that and doing that. But just really because of the crowd I fell into, really. And it all just built from there, and it was just an opportunity to make a bit of money. I knew of other people that were doing it just on a real small time basis. And then I moved in with a group of my mates into here. And it just so happened that at least three of them were sort of into doing that. That room there used to, we had all the plants in there, so my mate lived in there, and he decided that he would have all the plants and allergen plants in his room. God knows what that did to him, and it all got a bit heavy, and you know, you have people in the front room doing crack and stuff like that. It's just, it wasn't for me. None of that was for me. It feels a bit weird being back here, because it's about 8 years since I've been here, and you just, like, things enter your head, don't they, like of what you used to do. And because, I don't know, you can think of things 8 years ago and it doesn't seem very long at all. But when you consider how much my life has changed and where it could have been, it's actually a hell of a lot has happened, so. Yeah, look, you know, it was, things escalated quite a lot, I suppose, you know, when we've got a bit of a grow operation going on, and there was more money to be had, and people were interested in, you know, and and asking for different types of gear, you know. And I used to pick up in this area from a guy pretty well known at that time. It's been a pretty big dealer, and I got a reasonable amount off him, and I walked out of the house, and there was no other way to go. I had to go the way I was going, and there was a police car there, and two, a police woman and a police man, and they both looked at me. Now, they knew exactly where I'd come from, because they'd seen me come out of the house, so they knew what I'd been doing, and, you know, for all intents and purposes, they knew that I had something on me, but I guess they didn't know exactly what I had on me. And that's probably what saved my bacon, to be honest, is the fact that they were looking at him and they were looking at that house. So I walked past as confidently as I could and scarfed, got rid of whatever I had, and then just shut myself in my room. And I was bricking it a little bit. And because what I had on me, I probably would have got 6 years if I'd have been. Yeah, that gave me the kick up the bum I needed to. So I say you've been pretty lucky, you're riding your luck now, and to probably have a little bit of a think about your life and what you're doing. So at that time I was in a really bad way, you know, my mate Andy gave me a call and said, look, you know, come down to this session at Sussex Cricket Club. And he was heavily involved with the juniors, so he was coaching all the juniors and getting them through. But he said, look, you know, I'm desperate. I haven't really got anyone to come and help me. Whether that was true or not, I'm not sure. I doubt it. But he tries his damnedest to get me there. And you know, in the end, I did it for him. It took me right out of my comfort zone, because I was in my bubble. You know, like I was just with the guys that I would roll around with every single day, and we were doing the same things, and just got comfortable with that. So helping those kids was brilliant. It just gave me a sense of like doing something that was productive and that mattered. And actually I realised, you know, the rest of my days in that week, I wasn't doing anything really. Like I may have thought it was cool and like I was having a good time, but actually I really wasn't having a good time at all. I guess it sparked me into realising I needed to grow up, be an adult, sort my life out, and stop wasting my days really. So he said, look, just come along once a week, you know, come and coach the juniors once a week. And it just so happened that once the juniors had finished training, the seniors would turn up. So, you know, it was more likely that I was going to be able to to play as well and train myself. Got a lot of people to thank really, but yeah, it wouldn't have happened. That day, it all started here. And that's work and cricket and the whole lot all come together. So cricket's given me an amazing opportunity to travel, to go to all these amazing places in the world and get to pull on the jersey and represent your country. You can't buy that. I'm just grateful to be there and grateful to have had the experiences to do it. I was a very, very unlikely cricketer, I think it's fair to say. And I think there should be a lot more people that take up the game that don't think they're going to be cricketers. Cricket teaches you about life. More than any other sport, I think, does. You know, there's degrees of responsibility. Your teamwork, you have to take responsibility for your own actions, but also the team's actions. Just give it a go. It's a really good sport.
For me personally, it was something that you couldn't see. I had the feeling of nausea, feeling of nearly passing out. I didn't want to come across as weak. You know, I was scared that my mum and dad would find out how I was feeling, and I needed to go and see someone who could professionally help me. You know, mental health doesn't have to define you, and it doesn't have to control what you do forever.
Come on eat your chicken. Come on.
For all I can remember, my entire childhood was playing some kind of sport. You know, if we weren't playing cricket in the back garden, we were playing tennis out in the front of the house. So yeah, as a young kid, I mean, this was the backdrop for where I played all my cricket. This is where I learned how to bowl, learned how to hold a bat. I think obviously early influences, you know, heavily affect what you do as a child, don't they? And if your father's a professional footballer, then there's probably going to be a football around the house that you then start kicking. So that's just what my childhood was to me. It was sport. One of the biggest things that I struggled with was I became a perfectionist, which in cricket certainly is just so unhealthy.
Nice. Cleanly struck. Skied. In the air. A chance. Taken.
Any kind of failure that I had, you know, I'd just beat myself up about it for days and weeks. And I wouldn't be able to get rid of that feeling of having failed at some point. I remember we had a series in 2016 against Pakistan at home. It was the first game that all my family had got to as a group, so that was a really special day for me. And the irony of it was that then that was the final game that I played for England for 2 years almost. I remember being on the pitch that day and I was down at fine leg and I had my sunglasses on and I remember having tears in my eyes and that horrible lump in your throat when you know you're going to cry. And I just remember feeling really out of my depth. And I almost felt a bit like I somehow kidded people into being in that situation. How was I good enough to play for England? And in a game that we were winning quite easily, I wasn't doing well. And it goes back to that safety that I kind of encompassed myself in, because I didn't put myself out there. I didn't, you know, go out of my comfort zone and challenge myself. And it was after that summer that I had a really bad mental breakdown. I spent 3 days in bed and I couldn't physically get out of bed. And I remember my dad came and sat on the end of my bed one day and I don't think he even said a word. He just sat with me. Oh, I was just in floods of tears, just crying. And like that, I think that's the power of mental health, that can, you know, how your brain, your chemicals, everything that goes on can affect you that heavily. I think mental health is a very different experience for a lot of different people. I know for me personally, it was something that you couldn't see. And then sometimes that makes it more difficult to talk about because, you know, as a professional sports person, if you're injured or, you know, if you graze an elbow or something, you can physically see it. Whereas when you're trying to explain to someone what's going on in your own head that you can't even explain to yourself, it's quite a difficult prospect. The big thing for me was working consistently with a psychologist and unravelling all those emotions that I'd, I guess, built up since I was 16 and started playing cricket more properly, I guess, and putting a lot more time and effort into it. And I think it was a big eye-opener for my parents as well to hear what I was really thinking and what my thought processes were. I remember my dad saying to me that day, he said, I couldn't care less how you did on the cricket field. You know, he said, I just want to see you happy. As soon as I started opening up and talking to more people about it, that was when I realised that I was starting to feel a lot better and starting to realise how to cope with everything, I guess.
Edson gone. England have an early one. It is Kate Cross.
I think those 2 years were when I was really working hard at that side of it, and couple that with getting back in the nets and working hard on skills and giving myself a better opportunity to be selected into squads. And I made my comeback game in 2018.
And talking about amazing, Cross gets the breakthrough.
I feel like I've just got such a healthier relationship with the sport now. And, you know, I take it for what it is and realise that you can't be that perfectionist that I prided myself on being a couple of years ago.
But she's not just a role player, she is a wicket taker at the top of the order as well.
When you go through an adverse scenario and you come out of it on the other side, those moments then are a little bit more special because personally, you know how hard you've worked, and I know what those 2 years looked like for me. No one else will do. And so for me to be able to come out of that on the other side just kind of proved that mental health doesn't have to define you and it doesn't have to control what you do forever.
Must be close. Things are just not getting any better for Ricky Ponting.
When I was younger, my dad would always have cricket on the telly, always watching the highlights.
That's lovely cricket.
I always had such an open mind that I was really oblivious to how male-dominated the sport was, and my men's cricket was on the telly and women's cricket wasn't. I'm a community cricket coach and I work on projects for ladies and girls, creating opportunities for them. They're free projects, targeting the South Asian community, giving them a more comfortable setting, a more acceptable setting, trying to encourage them to get involved in some way or another.
See, that base of that tree was the stump. She was quite sneaky. When we had people visiting with kids, family or whoever, while we were talking, she surrounded them up in the garden. That's when the balls came out.
Everyone used to call me sad at school.
And then
I was a cricket girl.
Play with boys a lot as well, didn't you?
Yeah, like I only played with the boys because you could only play with boys, wasn't it? Just as a child, if you really enjoy something, you'd want to do it again. And I think, yeah, that's probably how it sparked my interest. I found some kind of escape, some kind of comfort. It was almost like it didn't matter what everyone else was saying. Like the boys used to tease me at school. This is a secondary school, and there was this one boy who was well into cricket, and he absolutely hated that I played cricket. He was like, "Girls can't play cricket."
When she first started, I don't think there was many opportunities for girls to go and play cricket. I don't think the teachers actually got the girls involved in playing cricket. It's all a separate sport for girls and boys, sort of thing. There was a lot of challenges on the way, but I think she overcame those. It was her confidence that actually broke her through into the men's world, basically.
I went to Australia after I'd finished university, and I knew Australia is a cricketing country. So what I did, I just went on Google and I typed in women's cricket in Perth. And what came up was a whole list of women's cricket clubs, and it shows you the distance they are from where you're searching from. And they were all within like 3 miles. I was just like, how is women's cricket so well developed? It was quite a shock to me. Hi from it, Uncle! Good to be back here after so many years as well.
Yeah, you were a girl when you started off, didn't you?
Oh God, yeah, I was
small.
Yeah,
you were school and everything we used to play. Yeah,
as well,
enjoy
yeah.
Coaching.
Absolutely love coaching, really, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, I really enjoy it.
So as you can see from here, if you notice, there's no girls involved.
Yeah.
At this stage.
Yeah.
And if you go right to the end.
Okay.
You've got the girls involved.
Yeah. Oh, so many.
There you
are. I think
that's Nicky.
I love
it. Imagine getting more girls involved. Now, with your help, we'll get even more girls involved.
Even more girls involved.
Yeah?
With our 4 girls teams.
Moeen's looking for new ways to get cricket more accessible and fun for girls, get more girls and children involved. So today we've got Go in the Dark Cricket. It's something different, give girls that special interest to just get involved without even knowing they're playing cricket. Of the day. They've really thrown the day, they're umpiring, scoring, being really creative, got really stuck into the whole party vibe. Just this, just seeing their enjoyment and enthusiasm of just getting straight stuck in. Now that's what inspires me to keep doing what I'm doing and to keep trying harder to push it out there further. I mean, you may say I'm inspiring them, but this inspires me to keep doing it. Like, this is why I really love coaching cricket, where I really love getting involved and try to bring more opportunities for the girls to play.
There's so many opportunities in sport, in cricket, what a girl can inspire to do. From my work, I want to make cricket the norm for women and girls, just as normal as it is for men to play. I just want it to be more accepted, or get to a stage where the word accepted just doesn't exist. It's just so normal.
In our life, cricket was everywhere. We used to play cricket in the garden and on the back streets as well, and we all just used to come out after school on the weekends and just playing big cricket matches together. It was really good fun. Azim is my older brother and always just wanted to copy and do exactly what he was doing. I don't know if it was because I wanted to be like him that I really wanted to be in cricket, or did I actually really, really enjoy it that much?
We were a sporty family. When I was growing up, I used to come home from school and watch cricket with my granddad. I was very lucky that pretty early on, when I joined Barnsley Cricket Club, there's a couple of individuals who knew the pathways within the county setup, and they recommended me to go to a trial.
When I first started at Barnsley Cricket Club, I was age 6. I then played in the boys under 9, under 11s, under 13s team, and that was because there were no girls teams and there were no opportunities for just girls to play on their own. Obviously, being a girl, I was never going to get put forward for county age group boys trials, and because there was no one responsible for girls cricket at the club, no one really had an idea of where to send me.
I guess when I look back on those early years when I worked with Anna as a youngster and as a cricketer, the first thing that I remember is that she had such a fantastic smile, as she still has now. But also behind that smile, there's a steely determination to do really, really well, and a commitment to whatever she did. She enjoyed the game back then. She enjoyed playing with lots of different youngsters. I think there would have been challenges, like dressing room challenges of where she would actually get changed. And probably the coaches at the club weren't that used to girls playing the game. But actually, through the determination that Amna has and still has to this day, she was able to get through that.
जी बिल्कुल एशियन फैमिलियों में प्रॉब्लम आता है. मेरी फैमिली में भी प्रॉब्लम्स आए थे, ऑब्जेक्शन आए थे, मगर वक्त के साथ सारे ऑब्जेक्शन भी ख़त्म हो गए, क्योंकि मैं खुद एग्री था. मेरी बच्ची ने मेरे को कायल कर दिया था इस चीज़ पर, क्योंकि मैं होप कर रहा था कि साल दो साल के बाद ही स्पोर्ट छोड़ देगी, मगर इसने स्पोर्ट्स नहीं छोड़ा. मैं मेडिसिन की तरफ लेके जाऊँगा, मगर इसने स्पोर्ट्स की तरफ ध्यान दिया.
At the age of 13, I wanted to enjoy my cricket, you know, play without being judged by the boys and stuff. So I set up a lunchtime club at my school and just asked lots of girls from different age groups to come along. And it was great, numbers were great. And then at the age of 14, I started to do some coaching outside of school. I contacted local schools within Barnsley and just said, you know, I want to come and give free coaching sessions to girls. And again, it was great to see girls turn out and play. I realised how girls are attracted to cricket, but it within a certain environment, and that's around other women and girls. Seeing that made me realise that actually creating those opportunities is something that I should be responsible for, because I'm really passionate about the game, I really love cricket, and I want to give those girls those opportunities. I now work at Leicestershire County Cricket Club and work predominantly in the community, creating opportunities for South Asian females and those from diverse communities to be able to access the game in the most comfortable environment possible for them. And recently we set up a new program called Bolly Crick Hit, and what it is 45 minutes of Bhangra Blaz, which is fitness moves to Bhangra and Bollywood music, and then followed by that we just do 45 minutes of softball cricket. And when the women feed back to us, they tell us that they didn't actually realise cricket could be that much fun. I had no role models whilst I was growing up, so that made it hard for me to continue. There was times that, you know, I considered stopping, but I think with the work that I've done in Leicester, I've realised that seeing is really believing when it comes to role models and someone who helps inspire you as well.
The work that she's actually doing is quite selfless, to give opportunities to people who might not have them opportunities if it wasn't for the work that these guys do. So I think it's not so much about her, it's about giving to people that what she wasn't able to get.
Naturally, parents do. मैं पहले भी कहा कि proud feel करते हैं और मैं भी proud feel करता हूँ क्योंकि जो आमना ने सिखाया है, जो भी इंसान अगर कोई चीज सीखता है तो उसको आगे divert करना है. तो naturally मैं बहुत proud feel करता हूँ कि जो मैंने इसको सिखाया ये आगे दूसरों को convert कर रही है, वो दूसरे बच्चों को सिखा रही है कि किस तरीके से life गुजारना है और especially मुस्लिम लड़कियों को और normal लड़कियों को सबको ये support कर रही है.
I've always found that cricket has a bigger impact than just your cricket ability. Just playing in a team sport, being around others, trying to communicate and stuff like that, it really helps you develop as a person, and that's exactly what it's done for me. I feel that I'm confident because of all those experiences I had when I was younger.
If you'd have asked me when I was a kid, would you have ever thought by the time you were 24 you'd have been on two tours to play cricket for England? I would have said no, because like that thing was so far off in the distance, and it was so seen as something that only able-bodied people did. It's a nerve-wracking thing, I think, as an adult. Really, am I going to be able to do this?
So I've been a teacher since 2010. I teach PE and I'm also a head of house, so I've got like a pastoral responsibility in looking after kids from year 7 to year 10. When I was training to be a PE teacher, my course mentor was concerned about my ability to demonstrate skills, which I always kind of managed to find a way around doing, because as most people with some form of disability, we're fairly adaptable. We always tend to overcome what it is that's the issue. But the self-confidence to kind of put yourself out there when you know that every single year you come in year 7, someone's going to ask you, like, what happened there? But then it's quite good because you can come up with stories. So in my first 4 or 5 years here, we had 4 or 5 different stories floating around every year group about how I'd lost my arm and I had to stop one of them because actually one of the kids actually was attacked by a shark. So that wasn't like a story you could carry on. I'm finding more and more that kids now are afraid of failing and messing stuff up. And I'm trying really hard to get across the message to our kids that, well, especially the kids in my house, that you learn by failing and accept that, yeah, that's a challenge, rather than stepping away from the challenge. Because I wish I'd done that a little bit more as a growing up, you know, and really accepting what it was. And yeah, it's okay to get frustrated, but then don't allow that frustration then to stop you from going on and trying to do something a little bit different. There's times where you feel like, am I doing the right thing? Like, am I doing the right thing for me? The fact that I get to go and represent England, whether it be as a player or someone who's in amongst the squad, supporting the rest of the teammates, then like that's the proudest thing that you do. Then it becomes a question, am I doing the right thing for my family? Am I doing the right thing for my professional life? And that's where the kind of the questions come in. It's never really a long conversation after myself. It like lasts maybe like half an hour, and then it's like, don't be stupid. It's like, this is the best thing that you do. My background is that I was born into an RAF family. So as a child, I spent most of my like formative years and moving around different parts of the country. But I really enjoyed the whole process of moving, and if I was like physically able to, I would have stayed in the forces environment. This other lad that I went to school with, he was missing a hand as well. And on careers day, we went up to the forces station and we're like, so can we join? And the look on like the young like soldier's face was like, I'll have to go and ask a senior member of staff if I could. And we knew the answer already, so we just kind of walked off.
or Brighton Cricket Club. So this is where I had my first experience of cricket as a 21, 22 year old. I'd just finished uni and I was working in within the PE department at the local school, and in my first couple of weeks of working there, I got asked to go on a ski trip. And the ski trip had Darren Shimmons on it. He was the husband of the treasurer of the school, so there was a tenuous link there. And we just got chatting throughout the week that we were away, and I was like, I'm really desperate to find a team sport. And he was like, well, come and try a bit of cricket. And I was like, cricket, really? He says, yeah. He says, I've never done it, never played it competitively or been in a team environment before. He's like, just come down to Winter Nets and give it a go. It's a nerve-wracking thing, I think, as an adult trying to pick up something new. I think the main concern was, right, am I going to be able to do this? Am I going to be able to play well enough? I was kind of stood over there doing some catching, and Keith Miller was stood behind that fence over there, and he shouted across to me, have you ever thought about playing disability cricket? And that was my first kind of insight into, oh, there was a different pathway into playing cricket. I remember my first time that I went to watch disability cricket. That really stands out. I went to Madeley Cricket Club, and Shropshire were playing against Lancashire. And the wicketkeeper was a bloke called Dave Ingram, and he was in a wheelchair. And he took this diving, like genuinely this diving catch out of his wheelchair. And I was like, if he can play and do it that well, I was like, oh, there's nothing stopping me. So from there then, I joined the disability training squad.
So any wider than that, you can hit that side, but then you've hit that straight mid-wicket. Now you're giving no chance. Well, it's trying to find a symmetry, because in world cricket, generally, there's not many people who use one hand. In cricket, we use two hands, and we've got two hands on the bat, and we have top elbow. He'd only ever hit 1/6 in his life. By using one hand, he now hits it further, harder, than he did trying to fit in with the rest of the world.
My style pre-2015 was two hands on the bat, conventional, kind of tried to be as conventional as I possibly could, which meant that I was pretty restricted in what I could do. Whereas if I throw that off over there, I get my bat back out here, which I couldn't do in the first place, which then enables me to get my bat through with more momentum, which when you're batting with one hand is the important thing, because if it's here and you've only got that little punt, regardless how strong you are, you can't hit the ball that hard. So with it up here, it has made my life simpler as a batter.
So when I first saw Matt, it was a whole new experience to me. Because they're such wonderful people and their perception of what normal is, they wanted to fit in with the rest of the world. Normal's boring. Why not be unique? Why not be brilliant? Because chance to be unique happens very few times. To play for your country happens very few times. So I'm still pinching myself that this has happened, even in my time.
I think that we are very conscious of our own, like, own insecurities, so individually. And I think that my own perspective of that is that a lot of us, we overcompensate on those things, and we demonstrate a bit of bravado and a little bit more confidence than we probably actually have. But in a way, I think that's benefiting us as a side, because we go out with a confidence that actually, you know what, we're going to show what we can do, we're going to show off, like, regardless of the fact that I'm on club feet and I'm struggling to balance, keeping wicket, I'm still going to take blinding leg side catches, or if I'm missing a leg, I'm still going to run around the boundary, dive for a ball, stop it, and if my leg comes off, I'm still going to throw it back in. We're ordinary, everyday people who happen to have a disability, who happen to be in the top 15 disability cricketers in the country, who get to represent the country, and that, I think, makes it even more special for us, because it's something that we wouldn't have expected. Personally, I'd like to remain involved in it as long as I possibly can, whether it's as a player or a mentor or a coach or something, just to be able to give some grounding to those that are coming along, because we don't know where this is going to be in 10, 15 years' time. I mean, the ambition is that we're somewhere on a par to where the women might have been 5 years ago or where the women might be in 10 years' time. We don't know. We've come from this national squad of 15 to 20 disability cricketers who never met each other before, to this organised, structural, cohesive group of people that are going about trying to be the best in the world. I think that's like miles apart.
That moment I got dropped, I was in tears, I was heartbroken, and I realised that actually that's what I wanted to do as well. This is my home ground now, and I used to come here to watch the England men play, and I used to train here, I used to be here 3-4 times a week. I remember my dad surprising me one day with some tickets to an England game, and I was absolutely ecstatic. I was probably about 14. I thought, yeah, I want to play for England from that moment. I got into cricket through the lads playing cricket. Mum refused to buy me any kit outright. She said, you can play, but you can borrow a kit. And then I played a couple of games, and she kind of could tell that it was one I was going to stick at. She said, right, okay, then if you're going to stick at this, if you hit your first four, I'll buy you pads. If you take your first wicket, I'll buy you a bat. If you take a catch, I'll buy you your gloves. And I had to hit six for my helmet. And as people know, I'm not the best batter in the world, and I bat down at number 11. So it took me about 3 years. And I remember being in the middle of a game, and I hit one and I top edged a six, and I put my arms in the air, and I was like, I've done it. We hadn't won the game. I just hit a six, and I knew I was going to get my helmet. Growing up, I was left-footed, so I played left wing for Burnley and Blackburn as a kid, and I absolutely love football. I was in the car on the way home. Mum said, right, enough's enough now, you've got to pick. And I remember being in tears, saying it's not fair, I love them both. I guess football was easier than cricket, and I've always been a bit of a terrier and a bit of a fighter, so I went with cricket. It is hard. I still turn up now playing men's cricket, and everyone's like, is she playing? And I've got my whites on, I'm like, yes, I'm playing. So as a kid, I got that all the time, and this team must be rubbish, they've got a girl. But for me, it's like part of my behaviour, like I'm just like, right, I'm going to prove you wrong. As a kid, I was the wicket taker, and I think my team loved it, the fact that I was getting other people out, because they'd be like, oh, you just got out to a girl, because it would be -5 runs or whatever. It seems to be a running theme in my build-up to cricket, that I've had to prove a lot of people wrong, and I think that's made me who I am now, like the character. I'm a strong character, and these people that used to criticise me, I'd like to thank them, because without them doing that, I probably wouldn't be here now. I just remember turning up to my first camp, and I was so out of my depth. My fitness was poor. I remember we had to do a fielding challenge where you had to catch as many balls hit at you as possible, and I got none. And then we had to do how many can you stop diving, and I got none. I went home and I was absolutely heartbroken how terrible I realised I was. I remember I didn't get picked to go to India with the girls, got called one dimensional, which was true, but I was still on the academy for the year after. Didn't get to go to India again, and I thought, what else can I do? Like, I'm not good enough. And I think it was August, I got told I wasn't going to be on the academy anymore, and time to pack my bags and go. And I was in pieces for a long time, and I was devastated. And I think it was a week after I got dropped from the England academy, I got dropped from the Lancs academy as well. So it was a real tough time for me. My parents were amazing. They said, look, if you really want to do it, we'll support you, and you just got to work hard. The next move was to tell the Lancashire head coach that I was no longer going to play for Lancashire. I got in contact with Middlesex and asked if they needed a left-arm spinner, and luckily they said yes. I thought, I'm going to go somewhere where they don't know who I am, they've never seen me before, they don't know that I couldn't bat, they don't know that I couldn't field. I remember packing my bags, and I was on the train, and I was excited. I was really excited. I thought, this is a new me, and I'm going to play cricket for England and prove everybody wrong. As soon as I got there, I thought, oh, this is hard. Like, it was tough. I remember my first game playing against Kent, and I bowled 10 overs, none for 60. I thought, oh, it's hard, this Division 1 cricket. I was coming in 3-4 times a week, and working really hard on my batting and my fielding. found myself playing club games and I was scoring 50s, 60s, 70s and I saw a real improvement, and from there I realised that I could actually make it. Luckily, at the end of that year, I got the call. It was a relief. It was something that I'd been working really hard for and that I really wanted, and to finally get that call and them to say, you're good enough again. When I got this second opportunity, I thought, I've got to take it. There's no way on earth I'm going to let this go. Robbo pulled me to the side. He went, I'll see you on Monday. And I went, what's on Monday? I had no idea. He went, for the Pakistan series, you're in the squad. And I went, are you joking? And he went, well, obviously not joking. It's like, well done, you've been selected. I put so much pressure on myself. I was like, I've been given an opportunity here. I have to take it. There's no way on earth I'm going to let anybody else have this opportunity. And yeah, I didn't play too well.
Swept, and swept nicely. It's beaten the fielder at short fine. And a loose delivery gets the treatment.
Full toss and punished. Poor delivery from Hartley.
I just thought I'd let my career go. I was absolutely devastated. People will tell you your debut is going to be the best day of your life, but it really wasn't. One of those feelings where you just think, I'm not good enough for this. And obviously cried, as I do. But yeah, hugged my mum at the end and she was like, you've got that number. Nobody's ever going to take that away from you now. And the moment she said that, I was like, yeah, you know what, you're right. And I've just got to keep working hard. When I got the call that I was going to the West Indies, I actually thought I was like going to get released or something, because Rob was like, I need a word. I was like, oh no, I'm not going, but said I was going, and I was just happy to be on the plane. It was fantastic, and I played in a warm-up game and I was bowling double bounces and full tosses, and I was on tiers in the pitch, like thinking I can't do this again, like it's definitely not for me, and went into that first game and I think I got four, and I couldn't believe it. Honestly couldn't believe it, because the turnaround that I'd had from the warm-up game was just unbelievable. It's just really nice to know that it's finally going well and the hard work's paying off, and what I've done over the years is now starting to show. And for me, yeah, it's just fantastic to know that I'm good enough and the girls want me in their team. My parents have been my rock and they've been so supportive, and yeah, I owe my career probably to my parents. I just remember there's a photo on Getty of me looking up at my mum and dad and I'm crying, and that for me is the best photo of the World Cup, because I was just so thankful for what they've done for me and how they helped me get there. And yeah, just looking at them, I was so emotional. Been a bit of a roller coaster, and there's been some tough times and some times that I thought I was going to give up. So yeah, I wouldn't advise anybody to pick my route, but I don't think I'd change it for the world.
Growing up in Ireland, being such a small community, there's always a story somewhere in a town or a village or locally where people haven't quite made it, or there's an excuse. They haven't given themselves the best shot, or they found it difficult being away from home. If I was going to be good or make the most of my potential, I wasn't going to be able to do that in Ireland.
Mr. Morgan, good to see you.
Pleasure.
Welcome back to your roots.
Thanks for having me. This has changed.
This is a bit different, all right?
This is very different. This only used to be one net.
That's right.
With an old keg of empty beer as the stumps.
Concrete strip.
Concrete strip as well, I remember it. It's good to see so many kids out.
Some of them took the day off school for you, Eoin.
There we go.
You were about so big, Eoin, when I saw you first. And you dragged the bat from the car park there. The bat was as tall as you were.
That sounds about right.
We would have you playing under 11 cricket. You were probably about 7 at the time. And you would caress the ball around and you could manage an innings. It wasn't just a case of get runs and get out. No, it was a case of there's a 1 here, there's a 2 there, and we will just structure an innings. So Eoin became the linchpin. You became the linchpin of the side.
Every time I come back, it just looks small. Everyone when I was a kid looked huge. The boundary was massive. You can never get there. And all of my cricket was based around the nets here.
Sure.
So we'd come and Dad would go and play, or my two brothers would go and play, and me and my sister and anybody who was around, your two sons, would go in the net and spend the whole day there. And yeah, very fond memory of my childhood, actually, in the nets. Yeah.
It was a real community-based thing. Everyone lived nearby.
Yeah, a lot of it around this part of the country is family-based and community-orientated. It's actually structuring my life and giving me different disciplines I thought was very important at a young age. So I'm obviously very grateful for that. The rest of it's a bonus, to be honest. The rest of it's a big bonus. Mind if I watch? How you doing, lads? What's your name?
Harry.
Harry, I'm Eoin.
Carl.
Carl, Eoin, how are you? Having a good day?
Yeah.
Good. Beautiful day for you. What's your name?
Sean.
Sean, I'm Eoin. That's thanks. Good. Shot. Was that a leggy?
Sorry?
Was that a leggy?
Yeah.
Okay, very good. Nice. Did you try something different there?
I tried to ball everything.
Okay. Even when you bowl it out of the front of the hand, you still have to get through your action. So instead of just putting it there and getting through your action. So getting through your action means bringing your hip over, everything, full motion. So still commit to it even if you're trying to bowl it out of the front of the hand. No worries. Come here, nice action. Well bowled, nice.
You just coming in the gate remind me of the background of how far things have progressed since. Every year we have a name or two that impress and we just keep them interested.
Brilliant.
And as long as there's progress, now we have the first class structure in Ireland, there's something for them to aim for.
Yeah, that's brilliant. It's come a long way. Yeah. Well, even today sort of epitomises it, that everybody has come out. Mm-hmm. And it shows how far cricket has come along. Remember the days we used to struggle for numbers all the time?
Yeah, your formative years were here, and everything that's happened since we feel is very much part of Rush. One of our Eoin has made it big in cricket.
This, he was that height when when I was playing cricket here, and I used to kick his bum every now and again when he get out of hand.
It's true. Here's a picture of my dad in 1992. There he is with a Slazenger. I think he was going for the Viv Richards look. So this here is my sister Laura. I'm not sure what age she would have been then. A lot of people won't know that my two sisters were fantastic cricketers and as good as the boys around the house. And they used to compete with us all the time and beat us more often than not. So yeah, she went on to play cricket for Ireland. It's two girls and four boys, all played cricket at Rush. Would have started maybe 4 or 5 just coming down playing in the nets. Probably my first game when I was 5 or 6 playing under 11s, under 13s. Also remember the birth of my youngest brother. My dad never made it because we were playing a game of cricket. And I remember the news coming back, somebody rang the club that Evan had been born. And Mum as well, so just showed where the priorities lied. I think the association, I keep coming back to talking about family, but the association it had with bringing us all together, and it was our Eoin thing. It wasn't a very popular sport. It was something that we played together that nobody else knew a lot about in the area. We lived about a 20-minute walk from here in an estate, and when I was 3 years old I ran away from home because it was a Saturday afternoon and I wasn't at the cricket. And my dad was playing cricket, but I didn't know he wasn't playing here, he was playing away. So I just went on my high horse and walked down to the cricket, and eventually somebody got hold of me and took me home. So it's my safe place, I think, being at this cricket ground. So this is the road I grew up on, and we used to live in that house there, the second one in. We used to play, literally there's not anything being built here. The playground wasn't there, those houses weren't there, and neither were those houses there, so there was plenty of grass to go and kick a ball and have a good time. And the start of the summer used to be the Grand National, and we used to pretend that we'd run up and down, jumping over the fences, pretending to be the horses in the Grand National. So, yeah, we'd do anything, pretty mad. Yeah, we used to play all our cricket around here. I'll show you around here. It's a bit different to Lourdes. So this was the strip that we used to play all our cricket on. So the rules were my two brothers were right-handed. Me and my eldest sister were left-handed, so all the slips all the way across the wall. You'd have a couple of fielders and then a bowler this end. And we'd play away, and it'd be great fun. And you'd get people walking across the grass here or playing football that would just look at us and go, they are mad. What kind of a sport are they playing? So it's quite ironic. You go from where I learned a lot of my cricket, just playing on the bit of tarmac over here with my brothers and sisters, to the local national school that we never played any cricket, and even probably to an extent where people would definitely look down on you if you mention it. Any comment you'd always get was always around, why are you playing an English sport or a British sport, which I suppose didn't bother me at the time, but is wrong when you look back at it, completely wrong. Like a lot of our underage interprovincial, so Leinster against Munster, the North West and the NCU were always played in the first 12 days of the marching season up the north. And we'd always travel up with regis in Ireland, always associate the area with where you come from. So a D reg is obviously Dublin. So that would always be predominantly Catholic area, going up and playing in different tournaments. And sort of around the time of all the troubles with a hard border where it's actually very similar to touring the subcontinent at the moment. There's a lot of army around, police around, but being in situations where you can't control as a kid is quite scary, because if you find yourself going into the wrong area, people turn the car upside down and just burn it. So experiences of that and people associating cricket with being a British or an English sport, I think that sort of always reminisces with me when I think about travelling up the north in the middle of the summer. Where I'm at now is like a huge credit to my family. If my family weren't around as much and supported me through like playing a foreign sport, there's no way I would have kept at it and stuck with it. Sort of growing up around here, it looked completely different at the time. Sort of the opportunity of playing professional cricket was never even a thought, until we moved from here, sort of in closer into this Dublin city centre. Because I moved school, we moved house, and I moved clubs, and sort of the opportunity to go and travel and explore playing cricket abroad, which was a huge dream. The opportunity to move school, not go to the local secondary school and go into town. And that opportunity sort of came about through my dad. He thought it was a really good decision for my cricket. They had a specialist cricket coach, which was unheard of around here at the time. And we're gonna focus a lot on their cricket. The first year I started at secondary school, me and my dad met with the new Cricket Ireland coach at the time, A.D. Birrell, sort of said that I wanted to go and play test match cricket. And before we'd met him about 2 weeks previously, my dad sat me down and said, well, what do you want to do? Where do you want to go with cricket? And I was like, I want to play tests. I want to play professional. And he said, that's great. Let's look into it. So I was like 13 or 14, meeting with the head coach, not even close to playing with the senior team. And my dad sort of spoke on behalf of both of us. He said, Owen's made a decision, he wants to play test match cricket, and we're just keeping you in the loop so it's not a surprise down the line. And the national coach was shocked, he couldn't believe it. I'm not sure if he was shocked because of the cheek of me or the cheek of my dad telling him what we wanted to do, but we were certainly, if we committed to something, we were all in. Declaring that I wanted to play for England early was, I suppose, a little bit uneasy for people around me, but it sat pretty nicely with me. You might get called cocky or overconfident or getting carried away, but there's no harm in shooting for the lights. At the time, Irish cricket was completely amateur, a million miles away from either turning professional or getting enough fixtures to improve their cricket. Being 13, 14 years old, I sort of realised that I had to go away in order to pursue what I wanted to do. So that was a sacrifice that I'd have to make. But having made the call that early is, yeah, pretty gutsy.
But I guess the real news of the day is that a gifted young Middlesex player, Eoin Morgan, will make his debut.
Eoin Morgan, not what he would have wanted. 4 runs required on debut. Well, he might just do it in style.
That's his career for Ireland.
5th player to play for 2 countries, and for Ireland, of course.
The first time I got called up was against the West Indies at Headingley. It's actually a rain-affected game. We didn't play. And then we went to Bristol and I made my debut there. But the whole feeling of having mum, dad, all my brothers and sisters there for the game really does make it special, because they're part of the journey, they're part of the dream, and have been there since day one. So I'm always a believer in debuts are as much about your family as it is about yourself.
Eoin Morgan comes down those famous steps at Lord's. It doesn't matter where you're from, the fact is you're wearing the badge of England. An enormous moment for him and for them, who are waiting to enjoy and appreciate the great talent that walked to the wicket.
The call came out of the blue. I didn't expect to be picked in the test team at all. I didn't think I was close at the time. And again, my family came across. My dad was extremely nervous. I remember he stayed, we had a small flat in Finchley, and the corridor of the flat's tiny, and from 6 o'clock in the morning, my dad was up and down the corridor in his shoes. So I didn't sleep past that. So, I mean, I go and watch my mates play cricket. I get more nervous than they are. It'd be horrible watching your son make his test debut. And then he left after 3 days because he'd had enough. So
His nerves couldn't take it, yeah.
But that he cares a huge amount. That's what matters.
There it is. The shot that's made him one of the best ODI players in the world. The Eoin Morgan reverse sweep. First boundaries hit in test cricket. Just happens to be that shot.
The first time playing against Ireland for England, I suppose, was a completely different feeling. I'd gotten myself into the position I'd always wanted to be in my life. And I was playing against guys I've played with since I was 7 or 8 years old, so it was quite relaxed in that way, but also a lot of pressure to go and perform and win. The first game we played was at the ground down the road in Clontarf, and it was rain affected from what I remember. And then the other game was here. Packed to the rafters, 10,000 people here, so a great day for Irish cricket. It was the first time they had these stands up.
These
Ireland players won't be giving any quarter to England. No love lost between these sides when any sport's being played between these countries.
It's a pretty hostile atmosphere that day. I think they come around to it eventually, but initially it's quite hostile, which is the nature of sport. Everybody's going to support their own team and their country. And Ireland played really well. They batted first and I think they got 280 or 300. And we got off to a bit of a stinking start. We were 40 for 4, 30 for 4. We were happy to get the win.
What a shot, what a way to go to 100. Over extra cover with a 6. Well played, Eoin Morgan. Probably just about back to his best now, the England captain.
Terrific shot. Nice ovation. He got one or two boos when he came in, Eoin Morgan, but he got applauded for his 50, and now there's generous applause here. It was what was once his home ground. He goes through to 100.
This ground is amazing. To do something like that on this ground is pretty special. The one thing that's carried me right through, the one characteristic that's always stayed with me, is the belief I've had in myself. Regardless of the form I've been in, how bad the situation is, I've always maintained either determination or belief, or maybe a bit of stubbornness in there as well, that I can get out the other side of it. And I think that's been an important part, I suppose, in me getting to where I am today. To aspire to get to something and achieve it makes you feel a huge sense of satisfaction.
Playing for England right now means absolutely everything. Every sacrifice that I made, that my family made, it means all those sacrifices have paid off. It's an extremely proud moment every time you put on the jersey and you feel like a different person, like somebody who represents a huge amount of people around the country and around the world, but also your friends and family, because they're part of the journey, what you're representing. It's a very proud moment every time you pull it on.